Recently, Netflix announced they'd be dropping a brand new anime adaptation of Kazushi Hagiwara's Bastard manga. Owing to that, now is as good a time as any to revisit Bastard's previous anime adaptation. How does it hold up? What does the new adaptation have to potentially build upon? What can we expect from an adaptation that will cover more of the source material? And for those unfamiliar with Bastard, what exactly is it? This is Abhi from the Cartoon Cipher, here with Anime News Network. Make sure to subscribe for more content, as well as follow Anime News Network on social media to stay updated.
Why would you defend a bastard like Dark Schneider?
The 6-episode OVA was created by Studio AIC under director Katsuhito Akiyama from 1992 to 1993, released in North America by Pioneer in 1998. The story is set in a Dungeons & Dragons-esque fantasy world with battles between ninjas, fiends, and sorcerers. The four Lords of Havoc seek to reawaken a god of destruction, and the only one who can stop them is a reckless, lustful, yet powerful sorcerer named Dark Schneider. However, he's been sealed within the body of an innocent child, only able to break free with the Virgin's kiss. Now, before watching Bastard, the main thing I'd heard about it online was its explicit content. Bastard is full of violent fights that sometimes involve gore, and is also pretty horny. Limbs not only come apart, sometimes they explode in fully animated glory, meanwhile the female lead Yoko almost comically ends up naked each time. Furthermore, Dark Schneider raised the dark elf child Arshus Ney as his own, but since this is a magical world where elves and sorcerers can live much longer than humans, eventually his adopted daughter becomes his lover.
I spent 100 years raising you to have that fantastic body of yours. You must know I love you.
At the center of it all is Dark Schneider himself, who isn't the most noble hero, but it's hard not to be in awe of him.
I want to kill every last warrior like yourself, and when I'm finished and you're all dead, every woman in the world will be mine for the taking!
He very much feels like a product of this hellish and brutal world inspired by heavy metal iconography. His name is arguably derived from the German singer Udo Dirkschneider after all, while many locations, other characters, and spell names are also inspired by famous metal bands or figures.
Megadeth!
The manga chapters that the OVA adapts shows this character as a brutal, womanizing, well, bastard, yet still incredibly firm in his desire to protect his human companion Yoko, and his egocentricity is legitimately amusing.
Everyone knows the macho bad guy can't win, especially when he's fighting the exceptionally handsome and popular main character.
There's plenty of laughs to be had in the hellish world of Bastard to balance things out. Some of it comes from Yoko bickering with Dark Schneider, never afraid to stand up to a former friend despite his threatening power.
You jerk! If you had a big spell like that, why didn't you use it in the first place instead of making us all suffer?
As mentioned before, Schneider's sheer arrogance is also a good laugh. He and the other characters occasionally break the fourth wall for good measure too.
What's the point of winning a battle if you're off screen when you do it?
The episodes follow his various battles against the Lords of Havoc and their forces, despite being a former comrade, as well as having little attachment for the kingdom who sought his help anyway. As someone who quote-unquote died 15 years before the series' events, his evolving relationships with both enemies and comrades alike form a solid backbone for the series' drama. Dark Schneider's disposition gets confronted by his adopted daughter-turned-lover-turned-enemy Arshus Ney in Episode 5, who believes the Lords of Havoc are fighting to create a utopia. Schneider roundly rejects this, of course, claiming that ignorance and hatred are at the core of human nature. It's a thematic thread that can be felt throughout the rest of the series' intense content. Most of the other characters are also memorable and distinct, though unfortunately, some like Kalsu don't get to shine as much in the OVA due to its limited runtime. The Netflix adaptation will definitely have the advantage of more time to cover more story events. However, one concern I've seen regarding the new version is the potential backlash all this sexual and violent content might receive from a modern audience. Some even fear that this content will get dialed down in the Netflix version, diluting the manga's notorious intensity. Personally, I think Bastard's style would fit in quite well with other dark, edgy animations that are popular on Netflix, namely Devilman Crybaby and Castlevania. If the old OVA is known for anything else, though, it would definitely be its outstanding visuals. Don't let the video quality fool you. The fantasy creatures are dripping with detail, while the effects animation for the magic and explosions are full of life. Although photosensitive viewers may want to be careful at some points. The action animation is obviously a strong suit, but the characters' facial expressions also go to great lengths to portray the tension of a fight in a more visceral way. A highlight is the animated backgrounds, which simulate exciting 3D camera movements and climactic moments. When these different aspects of the visuals come together, Bastard's animation feels truly iconic. It doesn't just excel in the action scenes either. The settings and backgrounds have their own intrigue. Even for a 6-episode story, looking at them made my imagination go into overdrive. Likewise, the imagery itself is nothing to ignore, and sometimes is punctuated further with colored light for extra dramatic effect. At a distance, this looks like a story about scantily clad girls and ultraviolence, but it can also be very beautiful. The climax of Episode 5's major fight was especially poignant. Everything from the music to the animation to the use of color hammered home the tragedy of Schneider and Arceus rediscovering their love in the heat of battle. The new adaptation might have its own great animation, but I imagine it'll be very hard to recapture the magic of how this OVA looks. Granted, the Netflix version will have the advantage of telling more of the story laid out in the original manga, where things ended up taking quite a turn. Bastard began its run in Weekly Shonen Jump back in 1988, but most of it was irregularly published in Ultra Jump, where it's still technically ongoing despite being on hiatus since 2010. At a certain point, the story starts focusing more on things like belief, morality, and religion, points this OVA never got around to. Perhaps this will give fans a chance to see these characters in a new light and get more personally invested in their stories. In any case, this media's English release stopped after volume 20, but even the Japanese manga's future is uncertain due to the aforementioned hiatus, so who knows how this new anime is going to end. The OVA did take some liberties with the chapters it adapted, whether it be condensing Schneider's first two battles into one, or peppering in some panty jokes during the first episode. Netflix Bastard could be an opportunity to keep in more details from the manga, provided it doesn't cause the story to drag. Series composition is being handled by veteran writer Yosuke Kuroda, who's handled some solid anime adaptations including Trigun, My Hero Academia, and Jormungand. The director, Takaharu Ozaki, has a notable amount of director of photography credits, and also helmed adaptations like Goblin Slayer, which itself is a popular dark fantasy, and the less violent yet atmospheric Girl's Last Tour. In this interview, Ozaki mentioned that as a child he was a fan of the Bastard manga, and has even paid homage to the volume cover illustrations in the OP and ED sequences. Ozaki clearly has a reverence for Hagiwara's story and art, which for now, bodes well. As for other expectations of this new Bastard anime, some aspects of its localization may change too. In a similar vein to the stands in JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, many aspects of Bastard, which were named after real-life musicians or bands, have slightly different names in the official English version, presumably to avoid legal issues. Metallicana became Metaricana, Anthrax became Anslasax, as well as some other unintentionally hilarious workarounds.
A far more graceful fate than that which Abigail's undead army is visiting upon Iron Maidan.
It's like, yeah, I wonder what that's a reference to. In terms of voice acting, we have confirmation that the Japanese cast of the Netflix adaptation will be brand new, so at this point it's unknown what that will mean for the English cast. The OVA's dub was produced by the same companies responsible for dubs like Cowboy Bebop, Ghost in the Shell, some Gundam movies and OVAs among other things, and featured actors that were common in those dubs. Wendy Lee, Steve Blum, Richard Epcar, Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, and so on. For the most part, the dub is great at immersing you in the fantasy world with its larger-than-life characters. While it can sound campy here and there, the ridiculousness is sometimes warranted, and I think you would be a welcome surprise to see these performers return to the series. The most memorable performance is probably of Dark Schneider himself by Darren Norris, who fans may recognize as various characters from anime like Cowboy Bebop,
"See you, Space Cowboy,"
or from cartoons like Fairly Odd Parents.
"And then if we don't, it'll be really bad, because you're so smart and I'm so dumb and blah blah blah."
Obviously, with the content mentioned here, I don't expect Bastard to be for everyone, but if this sounds like a good time to you, you're probably gonna love this 6-episode anime. It's a shame that it didn't continue beyond 6 episodes and adapt more of the original story, but it still did a fine job with what it did cover in my opinion. But please, let us know what your opinions of Bastard are in the comments down below. If you've seen it, what do you think about this upcoming new version? If you haven't seen it, does it sound like something you'd be interested in? If you've read the manga, how do you feel about its adaptation? Once again, make sure to subscribe to Anime News Network on YouTube and follow us on social media. Anime News Network puts out a new topic video every Friday at 1 PM PST, 10 PM PT. And you can catch the ANN After Show live every Monday at 9 PM PST, 6 PM PT. This has been Abhi from the Cartoon Cipher, and until next time.